Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. 'Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy.
Good morning, everyone. We're here live at LA Greek Hebrew Radio.
Woohoo!
With my special guest and friend, Chutney Berry, my personal yoga teacher. And we're here together in this beautiful morning talking about mindfulness, love, spices, and wellness. And I'm Batsheva, your holistic health coach. And yoga is part of my preaching, basically. It's part of a holistic is a whole thing. It's mind, body, and soul. So it's what we eat and how we, you know, how we live our life. Yoga, meditation, practicing, spirituality, and everything. And, you know, I'm very happy and honored to bring Chutney here. Just a little bit on a personal note. I mean, I know Chutney for, I don't know, maybe 15 years, mm-hmm. something like that. I mean, it started, it's funny. I mean, I went to a yoga class in the gym. Back then I was at LA Fitness, and I would never forget it because that was the moment that changed everything. The moment that changed my life. No, literally the moment that changed my life. I went to LA Fitness to, you know, a yoga class, New Year's Day. You know, it was New Year's Day, and I didn't know who the teacher was. And the funny thing, she was even subbing mm-hmm. that day. It wasn't even her regular class. And I walked in the class, and, you know, I see her sitting there and all that. Everybody is starting to come in and all that. And she was like, okay, everyone, so let's sit in a circle. And I'm like, circle? What is she? I'm like, I came to do, like, some... you know, yoga, yoga exercise, yeah. Like, you know, down dog, this and that. And she goes, like, she put us all in a circle, and she's starting to ask each and every one of us, what is our resolution for the new year? Because it was New Year Day. And, you know, some of the people there, I guess, knew her from before, because she was teaching at LA Fitness. And, you know, so we went through each one. So basically, like, you know, every person that, you know, someone said, I want to have more patience this year. I want to have more happiness. I want to have more joy. You know, everybody has had his own thing. And she matched an actual exercise to each of us resolution for the year. And it blew my mind, because I've never seen yoga coming from this spiritual aspect. And it was, you know, I'm like, okay, I'm hooked. And then I started to follow her. Like, back then she was just teaching at LA Fitness gym. And I started to follow her basically to wherever she was teaching. She had the classes in North Hollywood. She had the classes here, there. I was even following her all the way up to Hollywood on Sundays for classes. So yeah, that's how I first got to meet Chutney. And, you know, within the year she developed into, you know, she got more and more into, you know, to the spiritual side of yoga. And it was, you know, it got deeper and deeper and more evolved. And it's just amazing, amazing, amazing. And,
Well, Bathsheba, I just want to say thank you for having me today.
Oh, you're welcome.
And it's just a pleasure, and knowing you for all these years, and I've changed in the 15 years. It's actually been 23 years that I've been teaching, and you've changed.
Yes.
And that's one of the things that's so exciting about growing and yes. developing and sharing our development and spiritual practice with each other. It's yes. it's motivating and it's inspiring.
And we share the same birthday, too.
And yes, she's my astrological sister.
Exactly. We share the same birthday. So, yeah, after this short introduction of my personal story, I really want to go move to you, you know, to hear you talking. And I want to hear how did you get into yoga? Because I know you're coming from a musical background. You're
a musical background, artistic dance background. And so the thing that I was thinking about when you were talking is, you know, teaching for me is my creative expression.
Right.
You know, that's how I fulfill that creative drive.
Right.
You know, and so it's changed over the years, and I've lost a lot of students because of it, and I've gained students because of it.
Yeah.
But it's always been something that I've had to honor in order to grow. And so, you know, I started off as a dancer and a musician, and I ended up being in a lot of clubs a lot of time, and got into drugs and alcohol, and I actually got hooked on methamphetamines.
Oh, wow.
And alcohol and other drugs. And so I left that world, and I got clean and sober.
God bless.
With the help of a 12-step program. And in my first 2 years of that sobriety, I went to a yoga. One of my friends was a yoga teacher, and she asked me to come do yoga with her in her living room.
Oh,
and
wow.
She had studied with this really astute, very famous a yogi in India, Patabi Joyce. And she had a lot of information and essence to her that I felt was very real and genuine. And it just was like, I love this.
Yeah.
This is a way that I can take all that creativity, artistic music and dancing and physicality, and I can put it and channel it into something.
Into the light.
Yeah. And it was 1997, and that's when I started. And
so it's 22 years.
Yeah, 22 years. And so that started me on a journey of all these different kinds of yoga. You know, I started off teaching in gyms. I started off teaching hatha, and I went to flow.
Just so we let our listener know what you made. Your main practice is Kundalini.
Yes,
yoga.
Now okay. I practice Kundalini yoga.
Which we're going to talk a little bit more
about.
Yeah,
for the last 7 years. It's just that I just want people to know that just because you choose one type of yoga doesn't mean that you have to study that for the rest of
right.
your life. Things morph and change just like we do, you know, because we're creative beings and we're in constant change.
I can approve to that, because, you know, I've been going regularly to her classes, at least, you know, at least two, and if I can, three times a week, and it's always different, And she does do a variety of, you know, of styles in it. It's not just that, you know, I mean, beside the spiritual practice in it, you do use a technique of like different styles of yoga and not necessarily just, you know, when you do the exercises.
So I honor the Kundalini yoga tradition now. That was brought over by Yogi Bhajan in 1969. And it was funny, ironic, because he brought that to the United States and offered it to a lot of the people that were hooked on drugs and doing hallucinogens and psychedelics. It was the whole LSD generation, you know, and he noticed this whole generation of people and who were like had this desire, this longing to belong to some kind of spiritual practice. And he goes, I'm going to give them Kundalini. And what Kundalini is that I love so much is that it actually fulfills that need to connect to something that's bigger than me.
Right.
You know, and that's why I'm so hooked on it. You know,
I understand.
Yeah. So the process is personal for everybody. And so when I teach, I get to share my process and I really invite other people to find their own process and their own growth.
Yeah.
Because we don't ever want anyone to follow me. We don't want to follow Yogi Bhajan. We don't want to follow anybody. We want to follow our own path.
Follow yourself.
Yes, follow our own path.
Right. Because we all live here in a journey. I mean, we all have a journey to fulfill.
Yeah.
We're all going in this, you know, we have to follow our own path to fulfill our journey.
And
to where we
when
need to
I
go.
First started doing yoga, and for many years, like maybe 15 years after that, I didn't know what my purpose was. And finally, when I came into the Kundalini practice, it was offered to me, you know, my purpose can be as simple as I'm here to grow. I'm here to grow and I'm here to develop. And you know what? That's all I need. I don't have to know I'm going to be this and I'm going to do that and I'm going to do that and this and that and this. You know, it's like I'm here to grow and I'm here to learn. And I can attest today, every day I grow.
Yeah. Just one second. I want to acknowledge all of our friends that join in. Dorita Zuz, Mazal Vanunu, Esti Lieberman, Floyd Butler. A friend of yours.
Oh, yeah. That's my brother-in-law.
And
hey.
Carmel, S.H. Carmel, Gregory's Lagudis, and all the. Thank you for all the friends that join us today on Facebook Live with me, Batsheva, and my yoga teacher, Chutney Berry. So going back... talking a little bit more about Kundalini. So what do you think makes Kundalini, I mean, makes, what do you think is different, like, if you have to compare Kundalini to other yoga classes? Because there's so many yogas out.
Yeah, there's supposedly 22 different types of yoga.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and then you add all the variety of the teachers and what they bring to it. So there's just this whole, like, plethora of styles and different ways to interpret yoga. But the Kundalini is a very traditional, it was kept private for thousands of years. It's a very sacred, and it's for people who are 9-to-5, practical, we call them householders. It's for people who have responsibilities. It's for people who have jobs and families and have to be here on this earth.
So basically for all of us.
All of us, yeah. It's not for people who can go out into the cave and meditate for 20 years.
Right.
It's for people who, and so what it is, it's technology, meditations, pranayama, and kriyas that make the point and get to the essence quickly. So there's no fooling around. You just get right to the business. And it cuts through a lot of the resistances in our mind and our bodies. And it just gets right to the purpose.
Right.
Which is, you know, basically to feel that creative potential within yourself. That's what the Kundalini is. It's the creative potential of you. And what it does is it unlocks that potential in you so that you can start to heal things from the past. You can overcome addictions. You can change the way that you operate in the world so that you are happier and you're more at ease and you're more yourself. Yogi Bhajan says, the most high spiritual practice you can do is to be yourself.
Right. And I wanted to add to that. I know that Kundalini Yoga is a lot about breathing. Because I practice myself. I mean, believe it or not, when I was 16, I mean, I'm not that old, but I'm a little older. But my first introduction to yoga was when I was 16 or 17. And I'm talking about way back in Israel, when yoga was not like the hippest thing, right, and all that. Popular. But I don't know, for some reason I was drawn into that. But it was more hatha yoga, which means more asana.
Physical.
Yeah.
It's more physical.
What do you call it, the asanas? Or?
Yeah, the asanas.
The asanas. The more exercise, it was more physical. And there was nothing, you know, nothing that connects you to the spiritual side of it. And to be honest, I've done a lot more, you know, as I was growing older and all that. I've introduced myself to a lot more of yoga styles and all that. But I have to admit that until I met you, at least this was my experience, that until I met you, on that particular day, on the New Year's Day, you know, and I came to this class, and I was like, whoa, that's something different. You know, that's something that, you know, I'm not used to, because I did Kundalini classes before that were pretty amazing. And I'm really connecting to the breath technique that I want you to elaborate more about it. Mm-hmm. But the connection of, you said, the spirituality connection with the exercise, that's what makes the most, you know, the whole difference. So
yeah, so the breath is an essence, and it's a mystery, and it's like the magnet of life. It's also the joy of life. And so when we can start to approach our breath with an appreciation and an aesthetic, that it's something that we're born with the breath, we live by the breath, and we die by the breath. When you can start to relate to your breath like it's just exquisite, awesome essence, it changes you. And so we have all these different breath techniques that will help you with depression, will help you with anxiety and addiction. It'll help you to get to sleep at night, you know, and it'll help give you energy if you feel sleepy. So we could try one if you want.
Sure, sure. But let me warn everyone, if you're driving or anything, when you're listening to us, please don't do it right now. I mean, if you're in a safe place, if you're sitting somewhere and all that, by all means. But, you know, other than that, wait till you can, you know, this show is recorded and it's going to be in the library of LA Greek Hebrew Radio. So if you didn't get a chance to listen to us on live, please, by all means, go to the library and, you know, and listen to our show. So, okay. Yes.
Please. So let's just do a little bit of Breath of Fire. Let me tell you that.
Yeah, tell us what it's all about.
It boosts your immune system.
We're not lighting fire the studio. Right?
No. The smoke alarms won't go off.
All right.
And it also reduces addictive cravings. It actually pushes oxygen into your blood. So you look younger, you feel younger. It brings energy into your brain, and it helps balance all your nervous systems. I mean, it's just an amazing breath. And what it is, it's not shallow, but it's an equal inhale and exhale through your nose.
Right.
And in equal amounts. So it sounds like this. Okay. And we do it anywhere from 1 minute to 31 minutes. And the more you do it, the longer you can keep up at it. It comes from the diaphragm. As the navel goes in, your breath goes out. So it's... And each time you exhale, your navel pulls back, and then it releases and snaps back out. Now, sometimes when you're first learning this breath, it's nice to just a little bit focus on the exhale. And just allow the inhale to come in. And don't feel like you have to work at it too hard. You know, that's a little bit, you know, you might get tired doing that. So you want to find a light, fiery kind of staccato breath to help you and sustain you.
Quick question regarding that. So that would be a perfect breath to probably start your morning with.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right.
You know, if you're nervous, it'll calm you down. If you're sleepy, it'll wake you up, you know. And if you just need a little extra boost, like, you know, my teacher says, you know, if you want a cup of coffee, go do breath of fire.
Okay, so just one second. We're going to do it for 1 minute.
Okay.
I just want to mention other people who join us now. Michelle. Hi, Michelle.
Oh, hi, Michelle.
She's also a student
hi,
of
Andre Berry.
Chutney. Hi, Andre Berry. Sophia, Gianni, Marula, and Aline.
Okay.
And yeah, so we're going to go for it.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. And just out of the respect for the teachers that have gone before me and us, we always tune in with a short little Om Namo Gurudev Namo, which we do before every Kundalini yoga practice. Okay. And you want to do it with me?
No, you should do it yourself.
Okay. So I put my hands in prayer. We'll just do it.
One time.
We'll just do it one time. Om Namo Gurudev Namo. And then just sit comfortably. Close your eyes. Turn your eyes slightly in and up between the eyebrows and just concentrate there. And then just begin to breathe quickly in and out through your nose. Feel the in-breath, just as important as the out-breath. And see if you can equalize them and balance them so that one really isn't more important than the other. Find a pace that's good for you. Find a depth that's good for you. And when we're in our last 15 minutes, I'll ask you to go a little bit harder and heavier. We always go for the experience, not the idea, but the experience. So you're just feeling, concentrating. And the last 15 seconds go heavy. Work a little harder, deeper. Inhale deeply. Hold the breath. Feel like you're lifting up and out. Pull your navel slightly. And then through the mouth, let it go. Relax and just feel the aftermath of that. And then open your eyes.
Good morning, Chutney. I just woke up.
I know. It doesn't take much.
Yeah,
it
that's
really
pretty
doesn't.
Amazing.
It does.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, I love
Thank
it.
Thank you for sharing that. I want to go back a little bit to when you mentioned the addiction and all that, because I know that you're also involved in a group. You have your own group of yoga that you deal with. I know it's anonymous and everything, mm-hmm. but you help people, you heal people with addiction. It's a group of people that through yoga, through the Kundalini yoga, mm-hmm. you actually are helping them fighting and dealing with the addiction, which yeah. I think it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's an amazing concept.
Well, we all have habits,
right?
And we are creatures of habit.
Right.
And so Kundalini gives me this wonderful way of thinking about habits. I have self-promoting habits and I have self-demoting habits. The habits get so grooved in after years of repetition that they start to turn very negative and self-destructive. And then at that point, they're so bad that whenever I do it, it makes me feel even worse. So it's, you know, we start doing things because it makes us feel better. And most of us are just looking for ways to feel better.
Right.
And it's a very innocent intention that goes wrong. Or we want a quick fix.
Right.
And so in Kundalini, we turn our bad habits, it's energy, and we turn them into good habits.
Right.
So if I want to get off caffeine, I start drinking tea.
Right, replacing yeah. with something that is better for you.
And then repeat.
Right.
Repeat, repeat.
Practice,
and it's not rocket science.
Right. And just curious, those particular classes, and we go also, I don't want to forget to remind people of the location of every, you know, mm-hmm. where they can find you and all that. But as far as the class itself, is it conducted pretty much the same as your other Kundalini classes? It's a completely different class?
Yeah, because I work with people who are detoxing off of heavy drugs like fentanyl and methamphetamines and heroin. A lot of young people, you know, who just get totally wrecked by all that stuff. And so their nervous systems, and they're like, you know, a third my age. And they can hardly do a sun salutation. Wow. So I have to be very gentle with them because their nervous systems are wrecked.
Right.
Their attention spans are destroyed. They don't know how to control themselves in social situations.
Right.
And so I have to work with them in a very gentle way. And so it's a lot of coaxing and just trying to get them to participate and things like that.
And what are the, if I may call it, successful rate that you notice within, how many years you're doing that addiction group?
Well, I've been doing the addiction stuff since 2011.
Oh, okay. So it's like 8 years.
Yeah, about 8 years.
9 years almost,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And do you have some success stories? Like, I mean, at least... Do you get within all those years that you get, hopefully, to see like a lot of people changing the ways that the yoga was actually helping them with changing the way?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because a lot of the facilities I work at are all over the country. They bring people.
Right.
So there's not much follow through and follow up.
That would be interesting to find out.
Yeah.
Though.
I mean, I have experiences of the other where people actually die from addictions,
right.
You know, and that's the sad, sad part. But then there's people who have, you know, called me, you know, a year or two later, and they're, you know, got careers and they're having families.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's so rewarding.
Yeah.
I'm sure to
Absolutely.
Know that you actually help somebody change to, you know, to change his path, to make a transformation. That's...
Well, here's the thing. If you can change your destiny by changing one habit.
Each time, yeah.
One habit. So if your habit is moving a long time and it's just 1 degree, over time, it starts to go and you end up in a completely different place. So it doesn't have to be a huge change, but it can just be a little change.
Right.
You know, like, I'm going to stop complaining.
Ooh, that's a hard one.
So addictions aren't just substances.
Right.
You can get addicted to negative thinking, complaining and whining.
Oh, yeah.
Always finding out what's wrong with everything.
True.
You know, so you can say to yourself, I'm going to stop looking for what's wrong with everything. And then
right.
you catch yourself. And
so what, then there's like a certain time frame that they said that it works.
Yeah, we have like different time frames, 40 days to change a habit.
Right.
90 days to confirm a habit. 120 days, the habit is you. And then 1,000 days, you are the master of the habit.
Right. Interesting. Interesting. Now, another thing that I want to touch upon your practice is I know it's an exciting thing. It's a fairly new thing that you started to do, like maybe like a couple of months mm-hmm. ago and all that. I know that you're working right now at UCLA.
Yeah, I love it.
One of the, you know, the main universities out here in California. So I'm going to let you speak a little bit about what you do there, also with yoga. It has to do with yoga, of course.
Well, back in the 70s, Yogi Bhajan started a program up at UCLA to research the effects of meditation on Alzheimer's.
Wow.
I know. And so it's been going on for years. And right now I'm doing the research group for memory loss. Specifically for memory loss, and we're working with people in groups, and I'm teaching them a certain meditation called the Kirtan Kriya. And so I get together with them once a week. They get MRIs. Mm-hmm. They are measured in the brain with different kinds of they've got all kinds of great ways to measure brain function now, thermography and just all these really excellent kinds of measurement tools. So anyway, I work with them. And the thing about the Kirtan Kriya is that that's a meditation I've been doing for the last 6 years for 31 minutes a day. And it has changed my life.
But tell us a little bit more of what it is, that meditation.
So what it is you're speaking and you're touching your fingers at the same time. So I'm saying sa, ta, na, ma. And I'm visualizing a white light out through my third eye. And I'm sitting, and for UCLA, I teach it to them, and we do it for 12 minutes a day.
But they're sitting on the chairs. They're not sitting on the floor.
Either way, because some of them can't sit on the ground,
right.
And so they sit in chairs. And the purpose is just to be comfortable while you do it.
Right.
And you can look it up online, and there's all kinds of instructions that you can find online to how to do the Kirtan Kriya. But the thing is that so amazing is that meditation is revolutionary in changing brain chemistry, and
Absolutely.
It's something that's free. It's something that's accessible. You don't have to go outside and get it, and it comes from in here. And so one of the things that's real exciting about it is that it can actually help your DNA.
Wow.
These things, they're called telomeres in your DNA, and over time they shorten, and that causes all kinds of problems. And they found that over time with the Kirtan Kriya, your telomeres actually get longer.
Oh, wow.
You know? And they've found that the neurons firing in the brain become more active, and there's just more connection being made physically in the brain. And then you have all the people talking about how they're remembering things better, their concentration is better, their moods are better.
Wow.
You know,
that's,
so
that's
every
amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing. So it's not just a fairy tale belief system, it's actually a study on the physical manifestations of meditation.
So just curious, so how do people know about, sick, you know, people who has Alzheimer, how they or their family can find out about this program?
Yeah, so just go on to Alzheimer's.
Yes.
You just Google it, and you'll see all these different people who are doing projects around that.
Okay, so they can find you while they're doing this search on the internet? I mean, I'm saying, how can they find this particular program that you're involved with?
Well, it's through UCLA at the Semmel Institute. And, you have to apply to get into the program.
I see.
You know, and you have to meet certain requirements.
I see.
And
okay.
Then you just see if you follow the requirements.
Okay.
Yeah.
Since we mentioned UCLA, I also want to take the time to mention the other location where Chutney Berry is teaching yoga. One of them. And I don't know what happened to my collage I created this morning. It's a beautiful collage. I don't know, it disappeared, but we're not gonna worry about this right now. But I want to mention, the couple of places that I personally go to the classes. One of them is 101 Dance Center. It's on Ventura and Cahuenga. Mm-hmm. Tahanga?
No, Cahuenga.
Cahuenga. Yeah, that's one studio that Chutney has classes there on Tuesday mornings at 8:30. And on Friday mornings at 8:30. And beside that, she teaches at NoHo Yoga, mm-hmm. which is in
North Hollywood,
the NoHo, the area that is called the NoHo. So tell us a little bit,
Okay, so NoHo Yoga, that's on Tuesdays and Thursdays at 5:45 p.m. and Sundays at 9 a.m. And it's a really great studio. It's like a neighborhood studio.
Right.
And I think your first class is free, and you just come check it out.
Yeah, they have pretty good deals if you buy like packs with them and all that. But I want to tell the audience also how to find you. Like they can find you. You have your own website.
Yes, you can go to chutneyberry.com, and there's my schedule. And I do different workshops and retreats. And
yeah, I've been to one retreat. I have to, we're going to talk about the retreats a little bit. I have to mention my personal experience with you.
Please do.
I don't want to miss that. So It was, I think, when was it? Like when there was the super bloom at that time.
Oh, I think that was last year, 2018. Yeah.
So last year now, unfortunately for me, it's hard because the retreat happens a lot of time during Saturday, and I keep, I keep my Saturday, my Shabbat. So it's hard for me to get. But this time I was lucky because it was until Monday. Mm-hmm. So I had all my intention to get there, and I wanted to surprise her because all the time she was telling me, you have to come, you have to come. And I said, you know what, let me see if I can find a friend, blah, blah, and all that. And I talked to a good friend of mine, Orly, which also goes to Chutney's classes, and I convinced her. I said, we're going. Sunday morning, I'm picking you up, 7:30 in the morning, because it was all the way in Joshua Tree.
Yeah, which is about 2.5 hours.
Yeah, so... Yeah. 7:15, I was picking her up already, and we were driving there, and ta-da, we showed up, and she was like, oh my God, she was so happy. She was so surprised, and it made me feel so good. But it was an amazing experience because it's not like a regular, and I'm going to let you talk about it. Explain what
your retreats
are all
about. Well, on retreats, you know, you get to take your time. There's nobody knocking on the door trying to get in for the next class.
Yes.
It's more relaxed.
Yes.
You know, we eat good food. We go hiking on the rocks. We take, jacuzzis and swim in the pool and do a lot. There's just no time constraints. And I know living in the city here is just really a lot of hustle and bustle. So it's just nice to get away from all that.
But what's different? I mean, besides that you take your time, tell us a little bit more, like incentive, because you're having retreats all the time.
Yeah.
Like, not every week, but every few months.
So this particular retreat I do every year, it's called From Journey from the Head to the Heart. And I use that theme because it helps me stay focused on creating classes that get us out of our ego.
And we all need that.
And dissecting what the ego is and how does it, you know, hijack ourselves from having a better experience of this life, and how can we put it in its place? Because we don't want to get rid of the ego. We just want to put it in perspective.
Right. Yeah. We want to put it in the right place.
So it's not running the show, you know.
Exactly.
And because it can get carried away with all kinds of entitlement and arrogance and self-centeredness and me. And, we got enough of that.
Right.
We got enough of that. See, the thing that I love about yoga and Kundalini yoga is that it can also help us socially, because inherently we're social animals and we need to relate. We need to have interactions.
Right.
And it's really challenging in these days because everybody has so much stress and pressure.
So much negativity too.
So much negativity and so much polarity, us and them.
Right.
So with all the upheaval that's going on and all the differences, it helps to see that we're more than just differences and how to allow people to be different and still be ourselves without compromising our values.
Yeah, that's
and how to live in a world with peace and not have to be all the same. And right. It's like, we never talk about that stuff. You know, we're never taught how to deal with our anger. I wish they'd offer yoga in elementary school.
I think
and
they
it's
should.
Like, hey, honestly, kids, let's learn how to deal with our emotions.
You know what? I know that some, it's interesting because I know that some private school or high school, at least I know when my oldest son went to, they did offer yoga. They mm-hmm. do it more on the private sector as opposed, and it's a shame. They should have it available to everyone on the public system.
Right.
You were talking about all that, and I have to relay that every time, what I love about like coming to your classes, participating in your classes, is it first of all every time I go to a class, it's a different experience because there's always a subject that we're working on.
Yeah.
And this is amazing. And yesterday, I mean, I'm sharing it because it was, you know, live from yesterday, you know. So yesterday the subject was grace.
Yeah.
And it's always like, it's always something new and we're always working on something else. And it's like, in a way, it's like you're going to a yoga class, but it's also like, you're going through your own therapy. I mean, it's like getting high with all the drugs.
Yay!
You know what I mean? You leave the class, and sometimes when you finish the Shavasana, nobody wants to get up. It's like we're all there in that state of mind that we don't want to leave.
That's great, Shava. That's a real compliment.
And I think that's, I think if I have to think about it, that's what makes, to me, that's what makes you different. Then, you know, when I think about all the other classes, you know, that I took before, and I think this is so important to connect the physical with the spiritual together when you practice something like that.
Yeah. Well, I don't think it's me. I think it's the teachings. And I think.
And you. I'm not going to let you get away with that. It's you too.
She gets so bossy, I swear.
No, it's you. I want to give you the credit. Well, you deserve it. I'm sorry.
The thing is like, you know.
She's just so vulnerable and modest. And
it's just that, you know, we want our spirituality to be practical.
Right.
And so when we talk about grace, that could be a very spiritual and unpractical theme.
Right.
How do you pull grace into you on an everyday basis? You know, like when we're getting attacked by somebody physically or verbally with their negativity, how do we hang onto our grace? And this is the definition of grace that I was using yesterday was sacredly respectful. You know, so how do I deal with that, with someone coming at me who wants to harm me? And me and my husband have just gone through something like that, you know, and I was so proud of him because he didn't join in on the negativity. He didn't escalate it. He didn't, you know, interact with it so that it made it go even worse. And he didn't fall to that guy's level.
Right.
And so, you know, when we talk about grace and being sacredly respectful, the whole point of the class was to have that for ourselves first, which is a theme for many of the qualities that we're trying to cultivate, then I can offer it out. But if I can't respect myself, how can I respect you? If I can't forgive myself, how can I forgive you? So forth and so on. You know, so that's kind of the gist.
Right. And right. I also love that you know, being with the background of a musician, you always.
And I married a musician.
And you're married to a musician, a bass player. But coming yourself from a background of music, what I love about it, that there's always amazing music in the class. You know how to incorporate it, you know.
There's
so many
good musicians now.
Right.
Making Kundalini yoga music. And we're only allowed to use Kundalini yoga music
in
our practice.
Kundalini?
Yeah.
But I remember in the past you were bringing also other kind of music. I mean, you still sometimes bring other kind of music, which was, you know, just from your repertoire, from your own
library. I have a library that's 22, 23 years old.
Yeah.
You know, so there's lots of great yoga music. You can go to spiritvoyage.com. You can go to 3ho.org. You can go to the KRI organization, and these all have really great music. Even iTunes has got Kundalini music.
Yeah,
Apple Music.
You can find it everywhere. Again, for those of you who joined in, we have Chutney Berry here, and I want to remind all of you again where you can find some of our classes. You have the 101 Dance Studio on Ventura and Cahuenga, and you have NoHo Yoga in North Hollywood. It's the actual area is called NoHo. That's how they call it.
Yes.
So you have either Tuesday morning at 8:30 and Friday morning at 8:30 at the dance center, and Tuesday afternoon 5:30, Thursday afternoon 5:30, and Sunday 9 a.m. at NoHo Yoga. Mm-hmm. And you can find Chutney at her website, chutneyberry.com. You can find you know, some history about her, the classes, and also all the information about workshop that she's she's been doing, and she's the future workshop. Is there anything actually coming up real soon?
Well, I just got done with an addiction workshop, And it was really interesting, all the people and what they brought.
Where was it though?
It was at Yoga Noho.
Oh, okay.
And then, so that's over, but then now the
Can
next.
Can you share some example of just subject? I mean, well, not mentioning names or anything, just.
Well, it was really interesting. You know, I'm so used to working with people who are hardcore, you know? And this one woman came with a bread addiction.
Oh, okay. You get from everything, okay.
And another person came with this addiction to living in the past.
Oh,
where she was stuck in the past.
That happens to
absolutely,
you know,
especially if you have trauma. Now, Kundalini Yoga can address any kind of PTSD that you might have. In fact, I went through a pretty violent episode last year, and it caused me some trauma, and it totally has helped me. I feel myself really coming out of it in the last month. So through breathing exercises, meditation, and extra, you know, just regular exercises, you can get through. In fact, we say you can get through any block. There is a solution to everything.
Oh, that's very powerful.
Yeah.
That's very
so, powerful. And I believe it.
You want to touch a little bit more before we end, like a little bit more about what you wanted to talk about Kundalini and how what else is it good for, and you know.
Well, I'm just so excited about Kundalini Yoga because the effect and the power of our minds. And when you get a group of people together meditating together, you start to create a mass group thought, a group mind. And there was a mass meditation event last fall in downtown LA where we had 350 people doing meditation together.
Wow.
And, we, you know, meditating on people who are homeless finding homes, people who are hungry being fed, children who were unloved being loved, you know, and you get this group mass mental energy happening, and you can feel it's palpable. You can feel it. It's thick. It's like you can cut the air with it, you know. Wow. So this is stuff for the future. This is stuff that we're going to be able to access, and it's going to be the new technology, because this technology that we have, the latest pose, most popular pose, is called the iPhone.
Right. Listen, this is the world we live in. What can we do? So we have to have the balance.
Yeah. So there's a lot of people feeling lost and empty and suicidal. And it's because there's this lack of connection to our deeper self.
The void.
Yes. And so that stuff can be very positively used, but it can be a detriment too.
Right.
So, you know, Kundalini Yoga is a antidote to losing ourselves in the technology.
I just want to mention another thing, part of the class, which, I mean, I'm not going to sing it, but I just want to mention the words, because every time we end the class after, you know, we do, of course, you know, all the meditations and everything else, we always end the class with something with a song that is so positive and uplifting that I'm not gonna lie, that too many times it brought me to tears, because she's always telling us, you know, she's leading us with telling us, you know, think about people that you wanna, you know, to sing it for, to help, to share it with.
Serve.
So I'm not gonna sing it. I'm not a singer, sorry. But I mean, I don't know if we should, because the words are so powerful, and I really want to leave the people with that affirmation at the end. So I don't know if you feel comfortable of singing it, or you want
us
just to
say
the words.
I'll just say it.
Sure.
So we always end every Kundalini Yoga practice with the Longtime Sun. And this was an original song that was given in the late 60s to honor all the people who had given their lives for peace and world harmony. And so the words are, may the Longtime Sun shine upon you. May all love surround you. And the pure light within you guide your way on.
Amen. Amen. I mean, you can't, I think that covers everything, you know, the light within you, the love you share and you spread. I mean, to leave a class with this positivity and lightness, I mean, it's like, this is, I mean, this is how you leave. You go, you leave the studio and you go with this, it stays in your brain, you know, you leave with this, you go to work, you go to wherever you need to go after. And this is what you take with you, this affirmation. And I think it's so powerful and it's so,
and hopefully you feel it in your body.
Yeah.
And it's affected your mind. And,
Before we say goodbye, I was hoping, is there like maybe something like a very like simple meditation, like something really, really simple that you can share with that they, somebody can do it like, you know, in a crisis moment or, you know, or just, you know, you need to relax. You need to like, you need to ground yourself.
Yes.
Something like.
So this is called the non-reactive breath. Let's say you find yourself in a position where all this stuff is like you're just getting really reactive and you just want to lash out. You take up to 7 breaths, right? So you take a breath in, inhale, and you hold your breath as long as you can. And you hold your breath as long as you can. And you hold your breath as long as you can. You hold your breath as long as you can. And you hold it, and then you exhale. And you do that up to 7 times, okay? And it's a very simple technique, but try it. Don't take my word for it.
Yeah,
try definitely. It. Your experience is the guide. Your experience is your teacher. Your experience is the guru.
As you always say to us, we're a spiritual being living in a physical world, right?
Yeah, spiritual beings having a human experience.
Having a human experience. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I hope you thank you, first of all, to all of you listening to
you
us
so much
and being
listening.
Live with us. And,
it's been so much fun.
And I hope that, you know, I hope that you got the knowledge about, you know, how important it is to incorporate yoga in your life. I mean, if you can't do your Kundalini yoga, at least
go online.
Go online. Do practice yoga or meditation. This is part of the mindfulness. This is part of being a whole. You cannot just eat right. You have to do other things to keep your yourself alive and going. Mm-hmm. So I want to thank everybody again who joined us here. And, you know, thank you for LA Greek Hebrew Radio. And don't forget, if you want to, and I advise everyone to try at least to come to one class, because I promise you'll get addicted. 101's Dance Studio, Noho Yoga, and chutneyberry.com on her website. You can get all the information you need. And
thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for
coming.
It's
been really fun, Batsheva.
Satnam.
Satnam.
Satnam, everybody.
Satnam.
Satnam.